I constantly struggled to put down roots in a community that I could connect with.
I felt like my life took a major turn. I went through a divorce, and that totally shattered my image of myself.
The first time I was ever in that room, just looking at 14, 15 different faces and not knowing what we're doing there. And then slowly you start to see the progression of why we're not only there, but the stories and how they kind of like correlate together.
I walked into Rooted with, you know, seeking a purpose in my life. And 10 weeks later, when I came out of it, I not only had a church that I now call home, but I have this community.
Going into Rooted took things to a whole new level.
I was so nervous, but I met the people in my group and started coming back week after week.
You basically get to find out that you're not alone, like everybody else is going through the same thing.
One thing I will say about my Rooted experience that really spoke to me and I think spoke to our whole group is we served together at Amazing Grace Ministries. That day was so incredibly meaningful and impactful to me and to our whole group. I think it solidified our group, brought us all, I think, closer together and closer to God.
It was a great way to see how God is working in each individual one of us.
The group grew so much stronger together because every single person felt that they had really made a difference. Ever since then, our group has just really grown so well together.
Something that seems so, you know, potentially insignificant, like just a one-day serve event, really did have a huge impact on my heart because of where my life had led me up until that day.
It gave everyone a perspective that this is something we want to do all the time.
It was an incredible experience for me, as was the Rooted experience, and I'm looking forward to what God has in store for our life group, not only, you know, in community, but as we go out and we serve together.
The multi-site and discipleship pastor. And here at StoneBridge, we want to grow smaller as we grow larger. So while we are sharing Christ and growing in size, we have opportunities to be in community and build believers. In Hebrews, one of the books of the Bible, we are encouraged to meet consistently and to be an encouragement to one another. So that's why we want to encourage you to be a part of a group. So for adults, StoneBridge groups are available for you to join and participate in. And our groups are diverse. There are groups for community, serving, Bible study, Rooted, which we encourage everyone to go through, MOPS, Grief Share, and Celebrate Recovery. There are groups for men, women, co-ed, young adults, and students. So there is something for everyone in every stage of life. And groups will kick off each semester in February, June, and September. This will give you a chance to easily jump into a group experience. Our first group semester will launch in February 2024. So keep your eyes open for how you can join a group coming soon. And you may be wondering, is this for me? And we want to say yes. So maybe you've never been through the Rooted experience. Well, this is the time that you can jump in. Or maybe you're looking for care or need that in this season, and you can join Grief Share or Celebrate Recovery. Or you might just need community, like all of us, and you're going to join MOPS or a small group. And this can be really intimidating, but it's so worth it. So you can find more information at sb.church/groups. And did you know there's also an opportunity to lead a group? So if you are interested in leading, then join us next Sunday, November 12th, for a group leader training at the Omaha campus. And you can register at sb.church/groups. So you will hear more information about joining a group in the upcoming months, but we want to say jump in and join the experience.
Hello and welcome to StoneBridge. Whether you're joining us in person at any of our campuses or online, we're really glad that you're here. You can expect our services to be about an hour long. And in that time, we're gonna sing a couple of songs as a way of praising God for who he is to us. We'll also hear a message straight from the Bible that you can apply to your life today. If you're watching online and are near any one of our four Nebraska campuses, we'd love to have you join us for one of our Sunday gatherings. We meet every Sunday morning at our Omaha campus at 9 a.m. or 10:45. In Millard and Fremont, we meet at 9:30 and 11. And at Benson, you can join us at 10 a.m. We have kids ministry available for your kids ages birth through fifth grade at all of our services. And again, whether you're joining us online or here with us in the building, welcome to StoneBridge. Now, let's get ready to worship our God together.
Good morning, StoneBridge. I want to invite you to stand to your feet if you're able. And last week, we introduced this song called Praise. And if you're here, you know that you kind of have to move a little bit. It's got a lot of energy. But I just wanted to speak into that word again, praise. It's just so powerful. Every Sunday, I get to look to my right and my left, and I'm joined by this amazing worship team that just makes it so easy for me to take this belief that I have and express it to the King of Kings. It's encouraging to me to be surrounded by people who are willing to look a little silly and maybe be a little uncomfortable and lift their hands and clap and sing there at the top of their lungs. It's encouraging to me. And so my encouragement to you is that let's let our praise be like the light that we shine. Don't put a bushel over this time where you praise the Lord. Don't stifle that. Let it shine. Let it encourage the people sitting around you. If it's that you have a tough time singing, sing it out. Sing it loud enough to where your neighbor hears that you're not the best singer. If that's the case for you. If you haven't raised your hands before, I invite you, take a step out of your comfort zone and let your hands go up and express that you're just wanting to give him the praise and the glory. Or if you want to clap your hands, just join us. Join us and let your praise shine bright. Let's do it together. Come on. Come on. My firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. Oh, he won't. I
I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I build my life on Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down, he's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail. He won't fail.
Come on.
He won't. He won't. Strong on you. Oh, I'm gonna.
the surface of my anxious imagination, beckon to calmness that is found in you alone. It washes over every doubt, every imperfection. Jesus, your presence is the comfort of my soul. There's nowhere I'd rather be when you're singing over me. I just wanna be here with you. I'm lost in your mystery. I'm found in your love for me. I just wanna be here with you. Here in the waiting, I won't worry about tomorrow. No need to focus on the things I can't control. Yes, Lord, all my attention on the wonder of this moment. Jesus, Jesus, your presence is the comfort of my soul. Nowhere I'd rather be when you're singing over me. I just wanna be here with you. I'm lost in your mystery.
know that's our prayer for all of us. Every Sunday, we stand up here huddled and we pray that that would be your desire. That you could say from the deepest part of your heart, I just want you. There's pure joy, peace that surpasses understanding. In the arms of Jesus. I'm gonna pray, and I just ask the Holy Spirit moves powerfully in this space and just draws you in. Lord Jesus, your love for us is so obvious. We read in your book the lengths that you'd go. You came down to this earth because you wanted to be close to us. Lord, we just want you. Hungry for you, thirsty for you. We thank you for the wonder in this moment. This peace, the warm hug. Thank you, Jesus. Move in our hearts this morning. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Jamie Billerbeck, and I get the privilege of welcoming you guys to service today. It has been a wonderful morning of worship. And if you're joining us online, we are so thankful that you are spending a portion of your morning with us. If you are new online, please feel free to type in new here or first time in the chat, and the online host will get in contact with you, and we have a free gift for you. If you're worshiping in this room, it's amazing to see such a full space and hear everyone worshiping together. If you're here for the first time, or maybe you're coming back and checking it out for a second or a third time, we are so happy that you are here checking it out. If you haven't already, I would encourage you to check out our Welcome Home Center. There are people there that can help fill you in on what's going on here at Stonebridge. There's lots of stuff going on, especially this holiday season. Ways to get connected, ways to help serve, and we have a free gift for you as well if you are new here for the first time. It's our way of saying thank you for being a part of what we're doing. We're so happy to have you. We hope that you feel welcome. Before we move too much farther into our service, we always take a moment every week to worship through offering and giving. And it's our way of recognizing that we can be generous because God is so generous with us. And so there's several ways that we make that easy for you guys to do. We have giving online at sb.church/give. We have giving through our app, and there's boxes in the back as you leave as well for cash or check. And if you're like my family, we automate our giving because we automate what's important, and we don't want to miss an opportunity to worship in that way. So you can set up automated giving online as well at sb.church/give. And we're just thankful for everyone's generosity, and it allows the church to continue on in our mission of sharing Christ and building believers with our community and even around the world. So we're almost halfway through November, and holiday stuff is in full swing. And at our house, we are confusing our neighbors just a little bit because we still have some jack-o'-lanterns on our front porch. I have a turkey sign on my front door, and we've put our Christmas lights up. So we can't decide what we're celebrating this year yet, but I would be curious, a show of hands, if you guys have it a little more together than I do, and you guys have your Christmas trees up, your lights on your house, maybe Hallmark playing in the background. Anybody yet? Are we there yet? Okay. Well, we love holidays here at Stonebridge, and I just want you to check out the screen. Pastor Mark has made a video of an upcoming event that we have coming going on in a couple weeks.
I am so excited to be able to invite you to our annual Thanksgiving Eve service. It's become one of our favorite things we do around here. I remember as a kid, our church had a Thanksgiving service as well. It was really fun. In fact, I can still remember one moment in a Thanksgiving service where we just stopped and people gave a testimony of what they were thankful for. And this guy stood up. And he wasn't a leader in our church. He didn't really even know him very much. But he said, I am so thankful that I get to be a greeter at my church. And I thought, wow, okay. I don't know what you're thankful for. I hope you have some things. You know, our church, our world right now is on fire. There's a lot of messy things. And we probably need to come together to pray and be thankful. And I hope that you will join us on November 22nd. Worship kicks off at 7 o'clock and here at our Omaha campus. We've got kids programming as well. All campuses together, we're gonna have a great time. And I'm looking forward to bringing a message for that evening. Well, right now, we're really blessed to have one of our teaching pastors, Josh Dotzler, with us today. And he's gonna continue our message series, How Will I Know? And I hope you're really ready for this. This is a big deal. How will I know who to marry? And that is a massive question, right? It's a big decision. And you might be thinking about that. You don't know, right? Maybe you're dating, maybe you're not dating, and you're trying to figure all this stuff out. So Josh is going to unpack that for us right now. But before he comes up, we're going to hear from a married couple, and they're going to sing a great song. Would you please welcome Kat and Patrick?
Then I'll stop back.
Say farewell to the darkest night.
I see the coming of the sun. I feel like a little child whose life has just begun. You came and breathed new life into this holy heart of mine. Came back alive, aligned, just in the nick of time. One, you're like a dream come true. Two, just wanna be with you. Three, girl, it's plain to see that you're the only one for me. And four, repeat steps one through three and five, make you fall in love with me. If ever I believe my work is done, then I'll start back at one.
Just give a little, ooh, like a dream come true. My initial proposal was that I would sing the song, but they turned that down. First time I've ever been able to open up a message with Brian McKnight's song. How good is that? How many people know that song? You were kind of singing along. Man, we got to give it up for the beautiful Patrick and Kat, that rendition. I want to take that show on the road. You know what I'm saying? I think we can make a little money, do a little something. I love that song, and it gets right into the message for today. We're in a series answering and asking some hard questions. How will I know? And the question for today is, how will I know who to marry? And maybe you're here today, and maybe you're single, and you're in a season where you're asking that question. Whether you're here in person, whether you're online, wherever you are. Any single people in the house today? Come on, single people. Come on, if you're single, we're going to have you stand up, look around the room. We are going to find your one today. There's no better place to meet the one than right here at church. Whether you're single, maybe you're married. And you've had to answer this question, and you've gone through life, and you know, I believe that even today's talk as we go through this helps us, even as married couples, to A, remember why we're together, but also to take inventory of where we are. And we're all in a different season or space in life. Maybe you're a parent and you've got kids and you're praying about the person that they would marry. You're praying or having conversation with them about who is the right one for them in this season. Maybe you're a mentor or a teacher or a coach, and this is a question, a big question. And it's a God-sized question that I believe only God allows us to answer this question. And ultimately, as we answer this question, it points people to Jesus. As I was preparing for this talk a couple of weeks ago, I found myself at a bonfire, and I overheard some single ladies talking about finding the one. And I was kind of eavesdropping a little bit. And then they invited me into their conversation, and we asked the question to one lady, like, what are you looking for in a guy? And she starts to share her list. How many ladies have a list? Or you had a list? And she starts to go down her list. She's like, man, he's got to be handsome, good looking. He's got to have some money, have his finances in order. He's got to be in shape. She said, he has to be able to bench press more than me. She said, you know, he's got to be relational. He's got to be interesting. And she's going down this list, and we're just listening. And I said, wow, are you looking for a man, or are you looking for Jesus? I think Jesus can only fulfill that list that you're talking about right there. And then at the end, what got me at the very end of it, after she shared her list, she said, you know what, Josh, I'm really just a simple girl. How many men know what I'm talking about? There is nothing simple about that list. As I was talking to them, and as I was preparing for this talk and thinking about answering that question, how do I know who I should marry, there was a couple of different ways I thought about answering the question. One of the ways is we just look at the lyrics to Brian McKnight's song and use that as our gauge to answer the question, which he does share some insightful things. Another thought I had was, man, thinking about my own story. And if you're married in here, you've got your own story of how you met your spouse. And I was in college when I met my wife, Jen. We've been married for 16 years now. Got married in college, and we have a story. Actually, before the first service, I met a lady who had been married for 69 years before her husband passed away. I told her, I just need to bring her up and just interview her. We all have a story. But ultimately, as I was thinking about answering this question, it's not about my story, it's not about your story, but it's about God's story. And God has a story around marriage, and God has a story around answering this question. And so I want to answer this question by looking at God's story and really starting in the beginning, starting in the book of Genesis. And if I were to, you know, sum up my message in one sentence, ultimately, when it comes to answering this question, who should I marry? This is what I want us to remember. The person I marry is essential to God's purpose for marriage. The person I marry isn't the person I dream about, the person I desire, the person I marry is essential to God's purpose for marriage. And in Genesis 1 and 2, in the first book of the Bible, in the very beginning, when we see God's creation, when we see God's intent, when we see God's perfect picture for humankind, we get a picture of how we answer this question, who should I marry? And so we're going to look at the question, what is God's purpose for marriage, starting in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. It says, then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. The first thing that we see when we look at Genesis chapter 1 and we think about the purpose of marriage is that ultimately marriage is a reflection of the God we serve. The scripture says, God said, let us make man in our image to reflect us, to paint a picture of who we are. This is what Brian McKnight says in his song. He says, one, you're like a dream come true. He had one part of that right where he talks about this idea of a dream. And what we realize in Genesis chapter 1 is God had and has a dream for relationship. God had a dream and a vision that man and woman would be the ultimate reflection of the God that we serve. When we see in this first part of Genesis, he says, let us make man in our image. This idea of us, have you ever read that and asked the question, what is God talking about when he says us? Well, we serve a God, he's known as the triune God. One God represented in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And so in humankind, when man and woman are in right relationship with each other, you have man, woman, and God. We paint this triune picture of a triune God. And so the first thing that we recognize is that man and woman in relationship together are the perfect picture and the perfect reflection of the God we serve. I don't know if any of you have ever sent in your pictures and had AI produce versions of you. And my wife one time, she sent AI my picture. I think she wanted to enhance me. And so she sent in my picture and it sent back these multiple versions of visuals of me. And I'm not going to lie, I looked way better in AI form. I was stronger. I was more handsome. The version that AI spit back at me was an altered version of the current reality of who I am. And I think sometimes in life, sometimes in marriage, sometimes we don't realize that we are the ultimate, the perfect picture, the perfect reflection of who God is. And specifically in marriage, when man and woman come together in unity, it helps paint a picture of who God is. In God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we see one God in three persons, and each person of the Godhead plays a different role. And the same is true with man and woman. We bring different strengths, we bring different things to the table. Between my wife and I, and in every relationship, in every marriage, it can be reflected differently, but my wife is very compassionate. My wife is very empathetic. She empathizes really well with people. For me, I can be a lot less empathetic. I can be a lot less compassionate. And so in our relationship, she's taught me how to have more compassion for people. She's taught me how to be more empathetic for people. I've taught her how to be less compassionate for people and how you can't show empathy to everybody you engage. But ultimately, we play different roles in physically how we're wired, emotionally how we're gifted. But ultimately, in coming together, we ultimately are a reflection of who God is. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. It says, the Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. This is where I typically stop, and all the women said, amen. It's not good for man to be alone. God said, I will make a helper who is suitable for him. We see the purpose of marriage, first and foremost, is this idea of reflection. But the second thing that we see is this idea of connection. We're made to be in relationship with each other. Brian McKnight's song, he says, two, I just want to be with you. It's this idea that, man, when we are together, when we are in relationship, we want to spend time together. We were not created to live in isolation. And so as you're trying to answer this question, or you're in reflection based on your relationship, based on your marriage, do you want to be with the person that you're in connection with? And in relationship, obviously, you know, a lot of things start with a physical attraction, physical connection. You see somebody, you're attracted to them physically. But in this type of connection, we're talking about deeper than just physical. There's an emotional connection. There's a connection that says, man, I want to spend time together. I don't want to just be with somebody and do life with them. I want to be with my best friend. When Jen and I got married and we were still in college and had a couple more years left in college, and I went from having a roommate for 2 years and rooming with a friend of mine to then having my wife, my best friend, as my roommate. My apartment and my room went from being dirty and smelly to clean and cared for. I went from being hungry to fed. I went from having a friend to my best friend. See, ultimately in marriage, the way God designed it is that there would be a connection between man and woman, and we would connect on many different levels, and we'd want to spend time together. And one of the things that I recognize is a lot of times when we're first in relationship or we're looking for that person, we connect on a lot of different levels. And then sometimes as life goes on and seasons hit, we start to go in different directions. We have to be intentional about growing and building and maintaining and sustaining our connection. My wife and I over the years have tried to make it a habit to have date nights. And some people will tell us, man, date nights are expensive. You got to pay for babysitters. You got to pay for food. You got to pay for activities. And what we consistently say is date nights aren't an expense. They're an investment. And that investment has long-term impact. Mark chapter 10, verse 6 through 9, it says, but from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. We're made for relationship. We're made for connection. Ecclesiastes 4, verse 9 through 12, it says, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up again. And again, if two lie together, they keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? And though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him. Then it says, a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Again, as we look at God's plan, God's dream, God's design, it's that we would be in connection with each other. How do I know who to marry? Number one, is this person going to help me reflect who God is? Is there a connection that we have that's deeper than just a physical connection? Number three, I love this one, Genesis chapter 2, starting in verse 19. It says, now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock and the birds in the sky and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man. And he brought her to the man. And men have been loving and eating ribs ever since. That was the wrong translation. It says, the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Brian McKnight's lyrics, he says, three, girl, it's plain to see that you're the only one for me. I love those lyrics because you can look at certain relationships and you look at certain people and you say, man, they are just meant to be. That they go together like peanut butter and jelly, like Chip and Joanna Gaines, like turkey and Thanksgiving, like Creighton basketball and winning, like Nebraska football and rebuilding. Oh, I didn't want to go there. But there's certain relationships, certain people that you see that just fit together. But the truth of the matter is, how many know, and if you're in a marriage relationship, you know that opposites attract. And a lot of times, those things that actually attract us can also, if we're not careful, distract us and divide us. It's one of the beautiful things as you're thinking about and asking this question, who should I marry? It's actually the person that you marry has what you don't have. But you need what they have in order to live out the purpose that God has in your life. There's a book out there called Five Love Languages, and it talks about how all of us are wired and we express love in a certain way and we receive love in a certain way. Most of us express love and receive love in different ways than our spouses. And I remember taking this test early on in our marriage, and I remember trying to express love to my wife. And I really valued one of the love languages is acts of service. And I really valued that. And so I would clean our apartment, and I would do the dishes, and I was trying to express love to her. And there was this sense from her that what I was doing wasn't really expressing love. And so I'm sitting there, you know, I'm probably getting a little frustrated. I'm trying to express love to you, and you're not receiving it very well. And in her mind, she's probably thinking, man, I wish you would just love me. And I didn't know it at the time, but her love language was words of affirmation and quality time. So I'm speaking my love language to her, and she's not receiving it because I'm not speaking it and communicating it in a way that she receives and values. And what I recognize in marriage, as we're asking this question, as we're in relationship, God brings two people together who are very different, and it's not so that we compete with each other, but it's so we complete each other. And so as you're asking this question, you're not looking for somebody who's the same as you. You're looking for somebody who strengthens you, who completes you, who adds things to your life that you don't already have, not somebody who's had the same experiences. It's also important as we think about this idea of completing each other. 2 Corinthians 6:14 says this: "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness?" Again, if you are on the front end in answering this question, it is so important that two people are in pursuit of God, not just in pursuit of each other. And as two people pursue God, you meet at the top and actually complete each other at a greater degree. And I recognize that in marriage and in relationship, as life goes on, sometimes the level of pursuit of God can vary within that relationship. But ultimately, we can only take responsibility for me. We can only take responsibility for what God is doing on the inside. And what I've recognized and what I've learned as I've worked with marriages and people who are in relationship is that we got to lead by example. And so wherever you find yourself as you're looking to answer this question, you're looking for somebody that is pursuing God at the same level you're pursuing God. And as you find yourself in marriage, there's a consistency in both of your desires to continue to be more like Christ. And again, I realize that on the front end, asking this question, trying to answer it, a lot of times we value the differences in each other. But then once we get married, those same differences that we valued, if we're not careful, we'll find ourselves criticizing. And so ultimately, in marriage, the purpose of marriage is that we would complete each other, that together we would live out the purpose of God on our life. Genesis 1:28, the first part, it says, God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it." I'm one of 14 children. My dad would always say his favorite scripture verse was, "Be fruitful and multiply." I would say that he did a good job living it out. Brian McKnight, on the fourth verse of the song, he says, "Four repeat steps, 1 through 3, we see this idea of multiplication. When it comes to the purpose of marriage and how do I live out the purpose, we see there is a physical aspect to multiplication. God brings man and woman together, and he does give them this mission, this call to multiply themselves and to create humankind. And in a world where, there's everything from same-sex relationships, this idea of multiplication is God's idea. And it's the way God created us. But it's not just a physical multiplication. There's a kingdom multiplication. And marriage helps multiply the kingdom through our example, through the way we invest in the next generation, through how we live. In the area where we live and where we serve in North Omaha, we serve a community where there's a lot of single family homes, single parent homes. And a lot of kids are growing up without a mother and father in their home. And I'll never forget when Jen and I had our first son, Joshua, and when we were at church, it was Joshua, it was Jen and I, my parents were a part of the church, and for a season, my grandparents were a part of the church. It was the first time most of those kids had ever seen multiple generations together in one place and actually loving to be around each other. I remember these young kids, age 3, 4, 5 years old, they would come to my wife and I, and they would ask us a couple of questions. The first question they would ask us is, can we live with you? And the reason they would ask that question is because the home they grew up in wasn't a very good home. They didn't have a mother or father. The second question or statement that they would say when they would talk to us is, hey, is that your baby's mama? Or is that your baby's daddy? And we would have to explain to them, no, we're married and this is our son. They had no concept of marriage because in their family, there were 6, 7 kids, different dads, didn't know their dads. Moms were kind of all, you know, all over the place. They grew up in an environment where they didn't have a picture of what marriage was. And I recognize today that's not just in our community, but more and more that's represented all over our country. And the truth is that marriage is that reflection. It's that representation of God's heart. And in our marriages, we get to multiply God's plan for humankind. That husbands and wives would love each other, be in relationship with each other. You're asking the question, man, who should I marry? Is it somebody that together you're going to be a reflection of who God is? There's a connection that represents God's design for our lives. There's a completion in working together. There's a multiplication that's going to happen because healthy relationships and healthy things grow. And then ultimately, there's going to be a level of maturation, a level of growth, a level of becoming mature. I tell people all the time, if you want to grow in your leadership, number one, get married. It'll help you grow in your communication, in your relationships. If you want to grow to the next level in your leadership, have children. The process of marriage and having a family and children, it causes us to focus less on ourselves and more on other people. And so we see there's this process of maturation that happens through a marriage relationship. Genesis 1:28. The second half, after God said, be fruitful and multiply, he says, rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. I love the end of Brian McKnight's song. He says, 5, make you fall in love with me. But then he says, if ever I believe my work is done, then I'll start back at 1. In any relationship, specifically a marriage relationship, there's always work to do. It's an ongoing process. It's an ongoing process of growth and development internally and personally, and it's an ongoing process of pursuing each other. It's never ending. But ultimately, there's joy in the journey because it's consistent with God's original plan and design for our lives. You're here asking the question, who should I marry? Is it a reflection of who God is? Is this person, this relationship, is it going to help me live out the purpose of God for marriage? Ultimately, what I love is it's not just about who I'm marrying. The Bible talks about in Ephesians 5:25, it says, husband, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Our marriage relationship is a reflection of God's heart, that as followers of Jesus, as the church, we are the bride of Christ. We get to reflect God's heart for marriage by being in relationship with God. And as the bride of Christ, we model what it looks like to reflect God's character. We model what it looks like. Man, you're here connected to church because we were created to be in community. We get the opportunity through being a part of the church, being a part of the bride of Christ, to complete each other. We're one body, many different parts. We get to multiply the kingdom of God. And then ultimately, we get to reach our potential by becoming more of who Christ has called us to be. Who should I marry? Who should I marry? Ultimately, the person I marry is essential to God's purpose for marriage. Father, thank you that marriage has a purpose. And we see the picture of that purpose in the beginning in Genesis, where you created man and woman to be in relationship with each other. Ultimately, God, we know that your plan isn't isolated to just a man and a woman, God, but it's a picture of what it looks like to be the bride of Christ. We get to be in relationship with you. Ultimately, through marriage, people get to get a picture, God, of who you are and what love looks like and how we're called to live in community with each other. I pray for people who are asking that question, trying to answer that question. I pray for relationships, God, who marriages who have been going for years. Lord, would this be a time to reflect, to remember? God, would these be points to pray around? And ultimately, God, would we make decisions on who that person is based on your purpose for marriage? God, we love you, we praise you, we thank you for your word. Thank you that it leads us and guides us into answering these hard questions. In Jesus' name, amen.
We are coming into the time where we're going to take communion together as a body of believers. And so if you didn't grab those elements as you walked in, go ahead and feel free to grab them now. If you're at home watching, you can grab whatever you have that's easy and on hand. I love that Josh talked about the bride of Christ and how we are all that, all of us who believe in Jesus and put our trust in him, we're the bride of Christ, holy, unblemished. Kind of creates that word picture for me of a bright white robe without coffee stains spilled on it or ketchup stains or little greasy handprints all over it. There's no rips, there's no tears, there's no lint. It's pure and unblemished. And that's how God sees us. He sees us as perfectly imperfect people because we all have flaws. But he sees us with those eyes. And as we come into this time of communion, we get to come into relationship with God and remember that that relationship with God matters first so that we can have correct relationship with others in the rest of our lives, whether it's our marriages or our friendships or our coworkers, that the relationship with God matters first. And that God, through Jesus, kept his covenant, and he asks us in return to just be the light in this dark world. So just take some moments this communion time to reflect on that, to maybe get back in right relationship with God so that we can move forward and be his hands and feet through the week. God, we are thankful for this message series. I think it hits everybody in the room, no matter what spot or what relationships you're in. There's so many great takeaways, but God, help us to remember you first, that you're always with us, walking right alongside us, giving us the tools to reflect your love to other people. In your name we pray, amen.
invite you to remain in this reflection. Just remain here. Spend this time with Him.
Spirits out, rushing wind, fire of God, fall within. Holy Ghost, breathe on us, we pray. As we repent and turn from sin, revival ember smoldering, breath of God, fan us into flame. We need a fresh wind, the fragrance of heaven. Pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out.
Ooh. Ooh. Pour your spirit out. Ooh. The hearts that burn with holy fear, purify. Faith and need, refiner's fire, strengthen what remains. So we the church who bear your light, lamp aflame, city bright, King and kingdom come is what we pray. We need a fresh wind, the fragrance of heaven.
That you were encouraged today. We hope to see you next week. Before you go, don't forget that we're having a lot of fun on the front yard right now. And sign up for the turkey toss. It's going to be a lot of fun. Have a great week. See you next week.